Welcome back to my channel. For those of you that don't know, I am the one and only infamous Kentucky Yankee, without a doubt. Today we're going to be working on my 1974 Honda CB360. I'm going to install brand new tires. We're going to check the wheel bearings and brakes. We're even going to replace a few old seals. Get the chain lubed up. I'll show you how you can check your spoked wheels to see if they're true. Without further ado, let's jump right into it.
A couple of El Cheapo Shinko tires, a couple of what appear to be new old stock from 1964 inner tubes, and a couple of new rim guards. I'm disappointed in my Harbor Freight lift. I love it so much, but it does have an issue. I'm not sure exactly what's going on, but I think when I let it down, that fluid is coming out of it, and I keep having to refill it. Cotter pin. That's a 7/8 wrench. I don't know what size it really is. I'm sure it's metric. What's 7/8? 21 millimeter? I'm not positive. Look how easy it's going to be to clean this aluminum up. It's in really good shape, isn't it? 14 millimeter, but be careful. If this is rusted, don't hit it with an impact because you'll twist the rod off. This beauty's not rusted. Millimeter holds this one on. Notice there's a piece of rubber underneath that washer. I'm going to remove the chain. Not necessary, but it'll make it easier. Check out that old master link. I hadn't seen one like that before. Our adjuster. It's got this little piece in there, so don't lose that. Spacer. Right side of the unit here, bolt, adjuster, spacer. Let's see how the brakes look. Survey says they're like new money. Lucky right there. Look at that. Nearly new pads. I said pads. They're shoes, but they're in great shape. Wheel bearing. This one feels pretty good. It's greasy. Ha ha. Yes, yes. Very nice. These bearings are in great shape. They're fine. They'll run many more miles. Sprocket looks great, and I'll show you what to look for. When you're looking at a sprocket, you want to see a square edge here on the tip of it. That's what indicates it's a fairly new sprocket. This motorcycle has been well cared for, or somebody has gone through it or something, because it's in really good shape. Time now to start the process of changing out this motorbike tire, something I absolutely hate, but it needs to be done, so here we go. First step's gonna be take the cap and nut off the valve. I just noticed two things before we proceed with our tire changing process. First thing, there's four pins right here and they go into rubber. And that rubber usually is wore, and there's a lot of play. When you shift this back and forth, there'll be play. It'll go click, 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 click. On this one, it's extremely tight and it feels good. My other discovery, a number 34 right there on this plate. I don't know this for a fact, but I'm guessing that's how many teeth are on the sprocket. If there's air in your tire, you need a tool similar to this to get the valve core out, or a good sharp knife to puncture your tire and tube, whatever you want to do. No air in this tire, but I'll show you what the valve core looks like so you know what you're taking out. That's your valve core right there, and if you'll notice, it's got two flat sides on it, and I have used cotter pins to get them out. All you have to do is unscrew it. The tire seats right up against here, and that's called the tire bead. We need to break that loose, just push it down, and it looks like it's already pretty much broke loose. They make tire tools. All I have is some old pry bars. I'll use screwdrivers or whatever I got laying around. If I want to protect the rim really good, not scratch it up, sometimes I'll tape the end of the bars, but I'm just going to try and be careful today not to scratch them. You want to pry this up, but as you pry it up, you want to push the tire down all the way around the tire. That'll make that bead slip down under it and a lot easier to get it off. Next pry bar, go down about 5 or 6 inches over here and get under it and pry it up. Correction, 4 inches on this one. I'm just gonna work my way all the way around the tire now. Sometimes you need 3 of these tools to get them off. Yoink the tube out of there. Yeah. Brand new tube this looks like. But the valve stem's been ripped off of it, and it wasn't me that did it. Same thing on the bottom bead. Get underneath the bottom bead and pry it up all the way around. I mentioned go 6 inches, 4, 5, 6 inches. The deal is, don't go so far that you have to pry real hard and you end up bending the rim, because that is possible. Just go far enough that you can pop it out a little bit and move on down the line. And again, if you need 3 of these tools, or 4 or 5, it doesn't matter. Just keep going a little bit all the way around. Not sure exactly what happened here, but it is evident that somebody put a brand new tube, and these tires were new years ago, and then they never did run the bike after that, so I'm not sure what's going on with that. Even the rim strip, you can tell it's old, but not been used. Little rust on the wheel, not the worst I've ever seen, but it does have to get cleaned up and come off of there. With the wheel all shiny and cleaned up, rust free, it would probably be a good idea to get some paint, pick your favorite color, maybe clear would be best, and spray the inside of this wheel so it doesn't rust again. I'm not really feeling it, but I guess it's just a necessary evil. My favorite color, by the way, is whatever I have left over laying around. Don't forget to tape it up or whatever you have to do to avoid getting paint on where you don't want paint on. There you have it, just beautiful. Now listen, you need to let this cure out for like 24 hours or a good long time because you don't want the paint sticking to the tube. I, of course, did not follow my own recommendation because I need to get this video done. Probably a heat gun and fan ought to work just as good as 24 hours. This is called baked enamel. Now on to the next step. My goal now is to true this wheel. You don't want the wheel going like this, and you don't want it hopping up and down either. There's a couple ways to check this. You can just use a screwdriver. Use a screwdriver and vice grip it someplace next to the rim where it'll stay one steady place, where you can check it, see if it's hopping up or down, or on the side like this to see if it's going in and out. Now I'll show you the other way to check it. What you're looking at here is a clamping setup to use a dial indicator. This gauge right here is actually the dial indicator. This gauge has a needle and it goes against the wheel and it'll go in and out and tell you how far off your wheel is. This wheel is almost 30 thousandths out, and there is actually a spec on that so that you know how far you can be out without feeling it, I guess, you know, without having vibration. So the goal is to try and get it to zero, of course. In my opinion, this is not necessary. Find yourself a nice straight screwdriver. Find a way to clamp it next to the wheel so you can see how much distance there is between the wheel and the screwdriver, and adjust the spokes to get it as close as you can. I want to be honest with you guys. What I did was spin this wheel and take a look at it with my eyeball, and I decided it's good enough for who it's for. I'm going to throw the tire on it, and let's roll with it. Two things we need to be mindful of when installing new slippers, and this is the first thing right here. It says rotation and rear. Rear indicates this is a rear tire, the back tire. There is a difference between the front and rear tire. Rotation. Pay attention to the aero. Just imagine the way the tire will be rotating on your motorcycle and make sure that the aero is pointing forward as it rotates. This is what your front tire will look like. Second, there'll often be a dot like this on your tire, and that goes where the valve stem is. The dot's there to help better balance the tire when it's installed.
Soapy water? It'd be nice if you have a spray bottle. I do not. Put it on the same way you took it off. A little bit at a time. Nice new tube. It's got powder on it already. But I'm gonna add some to it. Gonna put just a little bit of air in there. Try it, put it in there nice and flat. You don't want it twisted up. The valve stem will always be a pain to get in. Ah! I forgot. I told you there was powder on that rim. I was gonna add more. I was gonna use a little baby powder and sprinkle on the tube, and I didn't. I'm gonna go with it, but when I do the front, that's what I'll do. I just sprinkle a little on the tube and rub it around. Soapy water. When you do this, you have to be real careful not to pinch the tube. So usually when I pry it up, I don't go any more than 90 degrees. Snug your nut down just a little bit. It doesn't have to be crazy tight. Now I'm gonna take the valve core back out. This'll help the tube to settle in place where it wants to in the rim and inside of the tire. Put the valve core back in, and then I'll air it up again, and then we're done.
Many people will go off the maximum tire pressure on their tires and fill them up to that. That's not what you do. You use the suggested tire pressure from the manufacturer of your bike. Typically, you don't have to go digging through your manual to figure out the tire pressure that's suggested by the manufacturer. There's usually a sticker somewhere on your bike. Makes it a lot easier for you. Brakes. Spacer. Adjuster and bolt. Spacer. Adjuster. Washer and nut. Mark lined up with a valve stem. A little bit off, it'll be all right. Notice the tire rotation, it's like the bike is going forward. And that matches our arrow right here. It goes this direction like that, towards the front of the bike. This has to be installed before you tighten this big bolt nut. Rubber washer on the inside, steel on the outside. Be sure and hold the bolt from the back side. It's got a flat spot on it, and you need to line that up. Make sure it's pushed all the way through. 12 millimeter. Barrel. Spring. Adjuster nut. Just gonna get it close with the impact, and then we'll adjust it. Fine tuning here in a minute. We actually have to come back to this adjustment because the chain needs to be on first and adjusted, then we'll adjust this. Because it'll move it forward or backward according to adjusting the chain. Want to take this clutch cover off real quick so we can get in there and replace the clutch push rod seal that I believe to be leaking. Something's leaking. A little petrol got in there, I think. It stinks. If you remember when we first started it up, it had an oil leak, and I do believe it's coming from this clutch seal right here. I could be wrong, but I think I'm gonna replace this one. There's a seal in behind here, and there's a seal right here for the gear shift. Best if we just replace all three. 10 millimeter bolt heads. I'm just gonna pull this rod out to get it out of the way. Note that this end of the rod that goes in the engine is domed looking and this side's flat. Remember, this seal kit came with our bike, which was a nice bonus. Nice big pick for this job. Maybe it'll work. Beautifully, like it was made for it. You really want to be careful not to damage this shaft right here or this aluminum housing, so it's difficult. You got to take your time and be careful getting this thing out. There it is, it's out. I knew it was going to be a tough one. It's so thick, this seal, wide. I nicked the aluminum just a little bit here and there. You really need to take your time and get it out without any damage at all if you can. Let's see how bad this last one is. I don't think it'll be too bad. Easy enough. This seal is interesting. See the little nub it has right there on it? That's so that it doesn't spin. A little odd, it fits actually right here on the inside, right there in that slot. So that's a little tricky and weird. So here's another purpose for this little nub on this seal. This is the old one because I already installed the new one. This little hole right here is an oil passage to lube up that shaft that glides right here on this. So that also is another reason for this little nub. All of this clutch mechanism in here should have been cleaned up and greased up, all new, nice and new. But if I don't get this done, we won't go on a first rip. So we're going to skip it this time around and just grease it. Just four screws and a shifter so we can go in here another time and I'll show you how to do all that clutch stuff. A little chain lube may help this old rusty chain last a little longer, we hope. There are lines right here on the adjuster where you can adjust the chain to keep them even on both sides. What you saw me doing was just doing a little fine tuning on the end. I kind of count the turns. There's a spec on the chain deflection after it's adjusted of how it's supposed to be. You check it right about there. I'm not exactly sure what it is, maybe 3/4 of an inch. Not sure on that. I'll get back to this later. Now time for our brake adjustment. I think I got lucky because I think it's adjusted right. Pull it. So it's not rubbing when it's spinning, but with a little pressure, it starts to rub. This is set about perfect. I'm going to leave it just like it is. Now the front tire, and again, this one looks like brand new. but very, very old. 12 millimeter. I think this will just unscrew without loosening these nuts, but I'm not 100% sure. I can't remember. No harm in trying. I think I was wrong. 12s again. Now will it unscrew? Oh yeah. Yeah. Ah! Brake shoes are like new. This bike has just been a delight to work on. A quick check of the bearings reveals that they are in excellent condition, so we're in good shape. I'm gonna change this tire out. I'm not gonna film it. If you've seen one tire change, you've seen a million. Couple things before I get started though. These are actually stick-on car weights. They must have tried to balance this wheel and tire out. Must have been pretty bad with all that weight on there. Secondly, there's your yellow dot. Sometimes it's red, whatever. It's supposed to be lined up with the valve stem. And if you'll come down and look over here, there it is. That could very well be why this tire and wheel is so far out of balance and why they had to use all these big heavy weights to try and get it balanced out. On these, you tighten the front first, and it's going to be 22 foot-pounds is what I'm going to do. You need to look the specs up for yourself, though. Don't ever trust what anybody tells you on specs. Look them up in the manual. I kind of ease them together evenly. I kind of buzz through that quick because we're running out of time if we want to get a first rip today. Here's a spacer right here on this side. That's all there is on this. This side, there's just this piece and it's threaded and fits onto that bolt. That's it, pretty much. Not a big deal. I did screw up big time and you guys are going to be impressed with this, especially all the preaching I've been doing about it. Here's our valve stem. Look on the other side of the tire, directly other side, completely opposite. There's our dot. Look at that. That is really bad. So the reason that happened is because I really suffered with this tire. It wouldn't come off there. I ended up having to cut the bead right there just to get the tire off. And I guess because of all that, struggling with it, I just got distracted and didn't line it up like I was supposed to. Front brake cable adjustment is right here. I did it the same way as the rear. It's not a big deal. These you can adjust up here, but it wasn't necessary. This one's already in good shape. So there it is, it's starting to look like a motorbike, an awfully nice motorbike at that if you ask me. A view of the other side. Keep in mind we still have a long, long way to go. This motorbike still needs a lot of work. I'm just wanting to go on a first rip. I do not at all recommend that you get in a hurry like I did to work on a motorcycle. That's a mistake. That's how people get hurt. For example, remember the cotter pin? I didn't fold it over, and it's lucky I saw it, and I did now. Another example, before I took it off the table, I saw this little hairpin and I forgot to install that. Not to mention the major screw up with the front wheel. Good grief. Thank you.
I want to thank everybody for watching. We did go on a first rip, even though it was short-lived. More to come. Next time you see this bike, we're going on a top speed run, and you will be shocked to see how fast I got this thing going. As always, thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.